multilingualism, which we discovered due to the large quantitative project of research project in Daghestan. So just to remind you, or there are some people probably who did not attend this lecture, so these are some details about this this project. It's a field work which takes place every year. Sometimes we go to Daghestan twice a year. It started in 2009, but only in 2012 students joined us. We started doing this research together with students, and it made our collection work much more effective. And so since that time, we've made field trips to 17 geographical clusters of villages, 17 groups of neighboring villages, from 2 to 4 villages in each cluster, which makes it 54 villages surveyed so far. This is the map. Clusters showing the places which were surveyed by our group. The survey is based on brief interviews with different people, and we ask them about themselves and about their elder relatives, their parents and their grandparents, about their linguistic repertoire, the languages they speak, or their grandfathers, grandparents have spoken. So this is Okay. So this is how the pivot table for each village looks like. This is the result of the quantitative data. So after we collect all these interviews, we calculate the ratio of people who are able to speak each of the languages which we are interested in, or each of the languages which we know are present in the particular situation. We calculate the ratio. For example, this is one village, Ginuch. I'm sorry that it's Russian, I just took this table from our working spreadsheets. This is the one village, Ginuch, and people speak in Ginuch language. This is minority language. These are the numbers about the native language. 100% of people speak it. This is one of the languages of their neighbors, Cez, and you can see that they all were bilingual in Cez. This is another language of their neighbors from other side. You can see that more than 86% could speak it. One more language, Avar, which is not present in the neighborhood, but still people can speak it because it is large language of the area, and it was used as a lingua franca for a long time. So 100% of population of this village could speak it. And this is Georgian, which is not present in the neighborhood. You have to walk for several hours to get there, for like maybe 6 or 7 hours, but people used to go there, so they also used to speak it. Almost about 60% of people could speak it. This column is for people born before 1990. So this is the period which we take as a period before Russification, before intensive contacts with Russian language started. And this is the generation born after 1990, and the picture has changed. So this is just to show you what we get as a result of one field trip. We have this pie table from several neighboring villages. And now I will discuss the result as a whole, the results for all these 54 villages. Every year changes, so I don't remember these numbers. so how it looks like in general, the picture of multilingualism in Daghestan. And for the beginning, I will speak only about this generation before Russian language came to the scene, only about people born before 1990. So I will speak a little bit about the difference between distant and neighboring languages and why is it important, what does it mean, why is it important, about the difference between neighbors and, so to say, second neighbors. And I will tell you about the global patterns such as symmetrical or bilateral bilingualism, asymmetrical or unilateral bilingualism, and lingua franca. So I will start with distant and neighboring languages. So what's, we introduced this distinction because we found it useful. Because in most places, people speak as a second languages, first languages of their neighbors, so people from the adjacent villages, which are usually at a walking distance of half an hour or two, from 30 minutes to two, sometimes 3 hours, but most often it's not more than 2 hours of walking distance. And distant languages. So these are languages which are not spoken in the neighborhood, but still they were acquired in the course of some special, often seasonal activities. For example, starting with distant languages. In South Daghestan, for example, in these four villages, these are Lesgian and Tabasaran villages in Southern Daghestan, people used, men, of course, used to go for seasonal oil extraction works to Azerbaijan. That's how they earned some money. So they used to go there rather regularly, and most of the population, of male population of these villages, did it. Then, Avar, in some parts of Pakistan, was a distant language because there were no adjacent Avar villages, but still people for some reasons used to go to these Avar villages. For example, this happened in Balkhar and Surikana, where people went to Avar villages to sell the pottery. They made some pottery well known in Daghestan, and they used to go to Avar villages to sell it, so they could speak some Avar. In some other regions, these such distant languages, Kumyk, Turkic language. In some empty villages, people could speak Chechen rather well. It also took them about 6-7 hours to get to Chechnya, but they had rather intensive contacts, but not like an every week basis, but more several times a year they would go there. And for this period, we can also consider Russian as being a distant language, because it was more or less also acquired due to these irregular contacts. So what's, why do we need to distinguish between distant and neighboring multilingualism in Daghestan? Because it is really different, first, with respect to the number of bilingual people, because normally you would find that these distant languages were spoken by less part of the population than neighboring languages. And second, because they are different in terms of gender. While neighboring languages were spoken by both males and females, distant languages were mainly spoken by males. Women almost never could speak these languages because they were not involved in these seasonal activities. When men went for a month or two to, for example, for seasonal sheep herding or for these oil extraction jobs or tin for tinning. Women usually stayed at home with children and cattle. So they were symmetric in terms of genders. So this is the picture which shows you this asymmetry. This is the region where people speak Andi. These yellow villages are Andi-speaking people. These blue villages are Avar-speaking people. And this is where people speak Chechia. So people from Andi villages used to go to Chechnya for different economical purposes, such as mainly trading, some exchange of goods, and so on. And this is the result in terms of bilingualism. So for the generation born between 1889 and 1940, this is their native language. Everyone spoke it. This is Avar, which is also spoken by both genders, both women and men, although women are a little bit, not 100%, but still most of them did. But these three languages, you can see that there is a rather visible asymmetry with these two languages. This visible asymmetry. So women could hardly speak those languages while men usually did, Russian and Chechen. So this is the difference between neighboring and distant languages. What means to be a neighbor? It's also not a kind of a controversial notion, not as simple as you could think of it. Because what we found out, first when we planned these trips, we aimed at getting to the places where contacting villages are neighbors, where we can go by foot from the village with one language to the village with another language. And that was it. So we always, more or less always, we had just two or three neighboring villages. But then, more or less occasionally, it so happened that we had to stay in the village which was a little bit further from the people who spoke another language. For example, there were some friends or something who could invite us to their house and so on. And so, more or less occasionally, we got the data on the villages which were not first neighbors but second neighbors. So you have to pass through another village to get to this another language. And we found out that this is relevant for the bilingualism. This being first neighbors is not the same as being second neighbors in terms of the number of bilingual people. Eight such cases when we can compare first neighbors and second neighbors, and in six of these cases, the rate of bilingualism is different. And in one case, there is a very slight difference, in another case, there is no difference, but never there are no cases which are opposite correlation I will show you the pictures. For example, these are, this is Luck Village, Valhar, Luck Village, Surikana, and Luck Village, Kuli. And they have Dagwa neighbors. This is the distance, about 50 minutes of walk, 50 minutes of walk. And so you can see that people, that there were about 30% of people in Valhar who could speak Dagwa. But 60% of people in Suricana who could speak Dobrushina, or twice more Suricana. So this slight difference in distance, like 1 hour or 2 hours, did make bilingualism really different, rate of bilingualism different. This is another case. These are Azerbaijani villages in Daghestan. This is, there are some Azerbaijani villages inside Daghestan. In people, and these are the Western villages. So people in, there are about 15% of population near sea who could speak some Tibetan. Not much, because in general, bilingualism was asymmetrical. All Western people could speak Azerbaijani. So still about 15% of population near sea could speak some Tibetan, but nobody in that part. Although the distance is again rather small. It's about 40 minutes of walking. Another example. These are Dagwa speaking people, Kadar Dagwa variety, Kadar variety of Dagwa. And this is Avar, neighboring Avar village. This is the distance of about 30 minutes of walking. And in this Dagwa village, 33% of the population could speak this language. While in this village, only 4%. So Avar was already irrelevant for them, although distance is still quite small. So this is why we thought that we should distinguish between neighbors and second neighbors and look into these distinctions and think about them, because, for example, I still don't have a good answer whether it is the distance which is important, or probably it is not the case of distance, but the case of indirectness of contact. The fact that you had to pass another village to get to these language neighbors, maybe that's what was really important. But we still don't have good ideas how to test it, because the situations are it's rather difficult to compare different geographic clusters. They are so different that it's really a problem of comparison. Okay, and the third issue which I wanted to discuss with you is this distinction between symmetrical patterns of bilingualism and asymmetrical patterns, and lingua franca. So which were found in Daghestan, and which of them were more typical for Daghestan? And so my example comes from this area. This is southern Daghestan, which borders with Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan is here in this corner. This is a big river, Samur, and many villages lie along this big river. Yellow are Utul villages, blue are Lezgi villages, and this pink are Tsakhur villages. These are three related but different languages. So this is the table which shows us these three villages. Three villages. Khlut, Lezgi village, Khlut, Rutul village, Kichia, and Rutul village, Rutul. So what we can see from this table is that in Lezgi village, Khlut, only 14% of the population could speak Rutul, their neighboring languages. Again, distance is about 50 minutes of walking. While in Rutul villages, almost while the other did not, almost did not. And what we found was that this situation is the most frequent one across Daghestan. So if you compare these pairs of neighboring villages where people speak different languages, you will see that usually the contact is asymmetrical. So these are pairs of neighboring villages, for example, Zilo, Andi village, and Kizhani, Amor village. This is the number of people in this village who could speak their language. So 94% could speak this language. And this is the number of people in this village who could speak the language from the village Zilo. And this is just the ratio of these two numbers, just the one number is divided into another. So this would be called the degree of symmetry. So what we can see is that in most cases, this degree of symmetry is rather low. So in most cases, the relations were asymmetrical in terms of language contact. The contact was unilateral. There is more or less one case in our database, one clear case, when the relations were symmetrical with the Lak village and Afar village. So these two villages, more or less, both of them could speak the language of their neighbors. But there is also another case, which I colored with violet. Is it violet in English? I'm not sure. So I colored blue or whatever. And so what's special about it? Why did I highlight these villages?
Few speak either one's language. Few speak their neighbor's language. Both sides.
Both sides?
Few people from
few
one.
People, yeah, yeah. Exactly. Few people speak the languages of their neighbors. So the special in these villages is that both numbers are rather low. You can see that only 30% from this village could speak this language. 28% from this village could speak the language of their neighbors, and these numbers are also very low. So what does it mean? What does it mean? What could happen between them, between these neighbors? Yes, so most likely they had some other means of communication. Of course, we could also suppose that they just didn't communicate, or we could suppose that there was a receptive bilingualism, and people can understand, but they wouldn't say that they speak the language of their neighbors. This is also the case. But what we actually found out is that these are the places where some other language was in the play. They used third language for communication in the front. For example, this was the case in some parts of southern Daghestan, again. Yes, so I'm again showing you this map. So I showed you that these two neighbors used for communication lezgi, which was rather big language of this part of Daghestan, one of the biggest languages in Daghestan, lezgi. So lezgi was preferred for communication. But in this part, these two languages, this pink one, Sahur, and yellow, Lutul, they are more or less the same in terms of number of people. Nowadays it's about maybe 7,000-8,000 people speaking these languages, Sahur and Lutul. Lutul maybe is slightly bigger. But what they did, they didn't the language of each other, but they choose for communication Azerbaijani. They all spoke Azerbaijani. Azerbaijan was very important in this area because these villages are very high, very poor. They almost always were hungry. There was not enough resources to survive. And so 7 months a year, they spent in Daghestan. And this was the rare case where the whole families moved, in Azerbaijan, sorry. When the whole families moved to Azerbaijan for several months, starting from September till April, most of the village spent time in Azerbaijan working and earning money to survive. So they all spoke Azerbaijani, both males and females, and they preferred to use this language as a language of communication between them. So this is the case of lingua franca. And there are also also territories where Afar was used as lingua franca. This is what we found this year when we went to this very multilingual area. It's even more multilingual than you can see here because for some reason I did not notice the Kitai is following as Karaka, but actually it's another language. Sometimes it is considered as Karaka, but it's so there are at least five contacting languages: Afar, Karaka, Tukita, one village language, Ahvah, and Bagvala. Colors are really, I'm sorry, colors. So these are five contacting languages, and four of them are rather minor languages. And so what we found this year when we made field research there is that they almost don't speak the languages of each other. They all use Afar. Afar was very strong lingua franca in this part of Daghestan. We also know that in some parts of Daghestan, Pumik was such a lingua franca, but we didn't make field research in yet here, so I don't have that to share. So in our data so far, what we found out was that most frequent type of language contact was asymmetrical bilinguals. Symmetrical bilinguals is very rare, but there are also rather large territories with lingua franca. But still the most frequent is this asymmetrical language contact. Okay, so why this is interesting? Because it seems to me, because there are several ideas about this small-scale multilingual societies, and it seems to me that they are not supported by these data, these ideas. First, people usually claim that the areas of stable multilingualism, and Daghestan was definitely the area of stable multilingualism, are characterized by the absence of language dominance. And this is definitely not the case of Daghestan, because what you find here is rather clear language dominance in terms of this asymmetry. Almost in all relations between villages, one language was dominant. One neighbor was dominant, linguistically dominant. Then there is another idea that the frequent corollary of asymmetrical bilingualism is language shift and decrease in linguistic diversity. So if there is such an imbalance between two communities in terms of language contact, then the situation is unstable and there's going to actually what Patti said today, that I can say the same about Dagestan, that it seems that there were almost no cases of language shift in the pre-colonial period. We don't know, we can't name any language which was lost before 20th century. Maybe, of course, it could be that we just don't have enough, we don't have enough knowledge about it. But it seems so, that languages started to be lost only at the end of the 20th century. And there are still no, in Dagestan, there are still no languages which are not spoken at all. But what we can predict for some languages that they won't be, because they moved from the highlands and to the cities, and so they don't transmit their language to their children anymore. But this had happened only recently. So although this bilingualism was asymmetrical, the situation was still very stable in terms of language diversity. And the last idea is that this linguistic asymmetry is caused by social asymmetry. So there is an idea that if one language is dominant, it means that this community is dominant in some sense, socially dominant. But again, it doesn't seem the case for Dagestan, because it looks like and this is what usually anthropologists say, that Highland Dagestan was a rather egalitarian society with no prominent signs of cultural or political domination of one ethnic group upon another. They all were illiterate. There were no languages which were really culturally more developed than others. And so it doesn't seem that this linguistic asymmetry was caused by some kind of social reasons, at least by some kind of political reasons, I would say. So it looks like to me that asymmetrical bilingualism was triggered by functional reasons than by social inequality. It is not that one village was more rich than another. Neighboring villages usually are more or less the same in terms of economy. They lie at the same level, and the nature is similar, so in terms of resources they are usually very similar, very equal. But there were usually some underlying functional reasons to be bilingual in the language of your neighbors. For example, quite often, this is the case of marketplace. If there is some a prominent marketplace in the neighborhood, then you most probably would speak its language, because you would go regularly to this place, for example, Pomuch, the Luck village with a huge, well-known marketplace, so people went there, and most people who could reach this marketplace would speak Luck. Or some important roads, for example, roads to Azerbaijan, and roads to the lowlands, and so on. So there were some functional reasons, but not the political domination. And as a result, this asymmetrical bilingualism did not lead to language shift. So you spoke this language because you needed it, but you didn't shift. You didn't change your language. And this is a quotation from Patiev's, who inspired this research, actually, in many senses. Coming back to the beginning, yesterday I talked about this notion of small-scale multilingualism, and that people usually absence of power or prestige relationships between languages. And they even define small-scale multilingualism as a situation where there is no hierarchy between languages. Well, actually, now I can say that I don't really understand this idea. I can't say I understand what underlies it, because in a certain sense, there is a hierarchy. People did choose one language upon another, but this is a functional hierarchy, but not a political one. And for example, Patti today told us about this difference between forest people and river people, and this is an obvious case of hierarchy in this small scale society. So, now I'm going to tell you several words about what had happened next. But, so, all this story was about a generation born before 1990, before Russian came to the sea. So, what had happened after that? There is evidence that at the end of the 19th century, Russian was spoken a little bit in Daghestan, but to a very low extent. So, for example, there is such statement that only one person per thousand could speak some Russian in Daghestan at the end of the 19th century. What happened then was that after Dagestan became Soviet, Soviet authorities opened secular schools in every village, literally in every village. This was a very successful campaign which was aimed at eradicating illiteracy, and it was really, really very effective. So they opened a school in every village, and every single child should have attended. They could not escape. We heard stories in the very highland villages where people were scared of school, and especially they didn't want to let their girls to go to school. And so they were fined if they did not, and since they didn't have money, so they couldn't pay, they were very poor. People could come to their house and take just anything, for example, a jar or a carpet from the wall, so just any item as a fine for not letting the child to go to school. So this was a very successful enterprise, and in the 1950s, Russian teachers were sent to the Daghestanian village to teach Russian and some other subjects at schools. So almost in every school there was one, two, or three Russian teachers, which are now remembered very warmly. They were nice people, they were nice to usually to local people, and they were good teachers comparing to the local people. So they remember them usually very warmly, and this is the picture which I'm very proud of. I found it in Archi, in the personal archive. So what you can see here is this woman who looks completely different from other women in this picture. You can see she has naked hands and legs, and her head is not covered. She looks completely different. She was born, we found her. We found her in Moscow, this woman. She was old already. We took an interview with her. She was born in 1930. And in 1950, she was sent to Highland Daghestan. This woman, young, very young girl from Russia. She spent there about 30 years, she has got married to a local man, not from Archiv, but from another village. And then she came back to Moscow. She had children, half Russian, half Dagestanian. Then she came back to Moscow. But you can imagine that these were first incomers in these villages, first non-Dagestanian people. And in most villages, even first people of another ethnic groups. Because as I told you yesterday, villages are very homogeneous, and normally they're just the representatives of this language and ethnic groups. This is also a nice picture. I like it. I will show you illustrating that everyone had to attend the school. This is the picture of this woman, this Archie woman, at her 7 or 8 when she started going to school. This is of course she didn't. It's obvious that this is a post picture because they didn't have such luxurious bags at that time. What they used were the simple bags which were made at home. But she became one of the first local teachers, this woman. She went to school and then she was allowed by her family to continue her education because she was not strong enough to work. She didn't have enough good health, so they allowed her to get education, to go to the city and get higher education. So, and this is what had happened to the languages. This graph shows the dynamics of Romanian Russian. These are the years of birth in our data. And you can see that, in this first group we lumped together all generations born before 1889, because we don't have a lot of data, it's not very reliable, so we will just group them all in one group. So what you can see is that the more and more people were bilingual in Russian, and you can also see this leap in the generations born in 20s and 30s, and these are obviously people who start going to school. So schools in most villages, schools were opened in 1336, 1337, 1338, more or less at this period. So people born in the 30s already have all attended Soviet school, and most of them could speak Russian. And since the generation born in 1950, almost everyone speaks Russian, except some very strange cases which sometimes occur, but still most people do. So what has happened after that is that Russian became an old Dagestanian lingua franca rather quickly. And this was the first case of lingua franca for the whole territory of Dagestan. Because as I told you, there were some lingua francas in the area, but usually they covered just some part of it. But Russian became an old Dagestanian lingua franca, and the spread of Russian boosted the command of other languages. This is another diagram. What is shown here is the knowledge of distant languages. I told you about distant languages. They were mainly male languages spoken by males. What you can see is that starting from almost the beginning, from the years of Georgia, and more people could speak Russian. And it seems that one of the main reasons why we lost this command of local second languages was that they started to speak Russian instead of acquiring all these languages. Yes, and this is another diagram showing the knowledge of at least one neighboring village language by men and women. You can see that it is also indicated, although this loss is not so dramatic as in case of distant languages. And so nowadays, these traditional patterns of local multilingualism are almost everywhere displaced by the use of Russian. There is still difference between people of different generations, and there is difference between locations. There are some parts where local languages are preserved better than in other parts, but in general that is the case. And it seems that this is a universal development. This, the same thing we find in many parts of the world. This development of huge, of large lingua franca, which cover big territories and which displace local languages as second languages. You have here an example of Pidgin in Solomon Islands, Tucana in Papua region, Pisin in Papua New Guinea, and Pidgin English and Cameroon, and so on. Okay, so I also wanted to emphasize that this is a collective project. A lot of people are involved in it, and it is very important because we would never have been able to collect such a vast quantitative data without our students. So every year a team of students goes with us to Daghestan, and these are some of them. It is also, this project is due to the hospitality of local people who help us, invite us, and support us. And there are other people involved in it. Help organizes the trips and maps which are designed by Yuri Krikov. And here you have some pictures of our teams of different years.
If you've talked to them about these patterns that, there's more people here, and perhaps it's because the market was over there that more people here knew this language than in that village that knew yours. And if there was local, if some of the local people would say, well, that's absolutely the case, or something like that, if there was any affirmation about perception.
Well, usually, yes, if you discuss with them, well, sometimes I was, I'm always actually I'm asking questions such as, for example, why do you speak the language of your neighbors and why they don't, if this is the case, and this is often the case, but usually they don't really give answers to this question. I wouldn't say that there is some kind of reflection about it. So, for example, they would say, that's how it is used. Sometimes they would say, well, it's because our language is very difficult for them. Or otherwise, because our language is very simple to be acquired. This is the frequent question. But I never got answers like, because they are more rich, or because they are more important, or something like that. Never, never. So usually they refer to the kind of custom. That's a custom. That's a frequent answer.
Okay. Yeah, but just follow up to that. Reminds me of the situation between Dutch and German. Dutch people learn acquired German from TV or from contact with German tourists in the Netherlands. So it's the same type of diglossia, whereas Germans would not make an effort to speak Dutch. They would simply assume that Dutch people speak German when they come to tourists. I think it's not characterized by social inequality, it's just a situation, and it's the same thing. Ritualized behavior. Sometimes people may give an ad hoc explanation that there are 80 million Germans in a small group, but usually not. It's just the way things are. This is how I grew up. You learn German, but don't expect them to learn Dutch. That's the way it is.
Well, the numbers of speakers, of course, do play some role in this situation of choice. For example, what we found out is that minority languages, one village languages, always lose. There is no one single case in our data when minority languages spoken by neighbors. I mean, there could be like 5-10% of people in the neighboring villages, if they are very close to each other, who could speak this minority language, but not more, never more. So the minority people are the most multilingual, always most multilingual. They speak 3, 4, 5 languages of their neighbors. They speak normally all languages they could, speak. So in this case, yes, the number of speakers does play a role, but it plays a role only on the local level. So only local level is important. For example, we found the place where Avar village, and Avar is the biggest Dagestanian language, it's a major language. But in this particular territory, Avar is surrounded by Dago speaking people. It's an enclave, just one Avar village among Dago people. And in this case, these Avars are a minority. They speak all Dago varieties around them, but nobody speaks Avar. So this number is important. It is the number on the local level which is important, the number in the neighborhood. And this is actually another interesting question, which I hope will address once, is to understand what is, in terms of, I don't know, kilometers, what is this territory, how big is this territory relevant for your bilingualism? It's another research question which I'm looking for. I'm sorry, there was a question. No,
just it was a small follow-up of what you said. Okay. I think that to add to the example of the Avar exclave between Dharmavas, there is this absolutely almost absolute symmetrical situation of Dharmava exclave among Avars, where Dharmava speak Avars but not the vice versa in the web versus a Volga. So you have an almost absolutely symmetrical situation in which two major peoples of Daghestan choose the language of indirect communication based on the local level relations in terms of number of speakers. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, it's really interesting. I was wondering about the way that some of the multilingual interactions are structured demographically. So for example, if markets are one of the places where these multilingual interactions occur, are they normally in, they normally take place in the communities of the people whose language is more dominant? And do they get people coming from different, from multiple languages that converge on that area?
Yes, these marketplaces are usually inside the villages or near them. And people from different language groups would come to there usually once a week. These markets took place once a week. So once a week there would be a lot of people coming from different places.
So is there reciprocity in where the markets are held? For example, one week maybe you go to the Avar village, but on the other week the Avar people come to your village?
No. Usually, no, not at all. So these places of markets were fixed, and they always took place in this particular village for, it looks like, for many centuries. And for example, so we basically know all marketplaces of Daghestan, now almost all of them. And there are also some territories where there was just no marketplace at all. This also could be no markets. There was no such exchange.
So do you think it would be reasonable to say that there might be a correlation between the placement of the markets and socioeconomic status, and then the language choice follows the markets, but it's also correlated with socioeconomic status, so through the markets?
Socioeconomic status of
people, the place where the market is. There's some reason why it's there.
Well, I don't know how to measure the level of their socioeconomic status apart from the very fact that they had this marketplace. I mean, I wouldn't say that there are any other features which could be ascribed to their status.
Could it correlate maybe with things like altitude and growing season? Any variables like altitude and growing season that might be relevant?
You know, in the neighborhood, they are usually the same. Mm-hmm. There is, of course, huge difference between lower villages and highland villages, but normally these people even don't know each other. So all these cases which we are talking about, these are the cases of the neighborhood, like 1 or 2 hours of walking distance, not more. And in this case, these villages are very similar in terms of economy, in terms of the wealth.
We may just add a small bit. It's not obvious, and it's only due to you think to explore, but one thing that may probably be the marketplace, and I think it would slightly, I mean, shed some kind of doubts on the universality of claims that have been done in this presentation, is that it might be that marketplaces are, they had a tendency to be slightly more ethnically mixed, because we have this data coming from late 19th century, for instance, Kumu, where it's the only village or town or village in the neighborhood which had some presence of people other than Laks. So I think presence of people from other ethnic background
may correlate with more complex social structure, and may be a small argument in favor of the higher kind of what you can interpret as higher socioeconomic status of Pomo. But of course, we don't have data, for instance, on the real estate there or on the level of prosperity, comparative level of prosperity in the village. So maybe we'll never have. I think what we lack so far in this study, and what we need to somehow to integrate, is the historical evidence on Hanates, for instance, present in the area. So one of the things why from one of the perspectives from which you would like to look at this story is what were the traditional or historical center of power center, which we never did yet.
I wonder if maybe you could also, or maybe you were, look at network structures. So for example, if you have a village that where the market is located and there's more ethnic diversity within that village, you might expect there to be more kinship relationships and so on, connecting that village to other villages that might help to give it a certain status somehow, or might contribute to its economic status if there's more goods flowing back and forth. I don't know, just an idea.
It seems to be the case now, at present, of course, because the centers, the administrative centers, are much more mixed than other places. Mm-hmm. But we don't know what happened before. We only know, for instance, as I said, about Pomo, which was an important marketplace, and it showed the presence of one Russian family, one Armenian family, at the time when none of these villages that Mina mentioned had any presence of anyone else at all. Uh-huh. But that presence is so small that maybe it's significant in terms of, what you're asking about. Maybe it's not, maybe it's incipient, something which never developed into a major factor.
Well, there's also the question of which comes first, right? So if maybe the market is drawing the people from outside, or maybe the other way around, or...
I wouldn't think so, but I don't know, of course.
Yeah.